and a big happy Valentine's to everyone. What a better way to spend a Valentine's morning than in church. Love this. Look to your left, look to your right, give someone a high five, give them a hug. So happy to see everyone. Really, guys, I really love looking out over y'all and just seeing everyone's faces, all the diversity that we got going on. I love it. This is just a slice of heaven right here. I love it. Okay, a couple of announcements we got going on. This Thursday night at 7 p.m., we have our congregational prayer. Congregational prayer is going on. We pray over different things. We pray over the government. We pray over our church leadership. I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you to come to this. This will help increase your prayer life. If you've never been stretched before, this is a good place to start that. I know sometimes we can get so wrapped up in our little world and with the stuff that's going on in our personal lives, and we forget the bigger picture of things. I want to encourage you to come to this. It's going to be this Thursday night at 7 p.m. that we can pray for our government, pray for our leaders, and just really open us up to the bigger things that God has for us. So that's this Thursday night. Next up, we have a new ladies' Bible study starting up with Shirley Hilton. Shirley Hilton was one of our missionaries, or is one of our missionaries, I'm sorry. And she's going to be speaking on a topic called Redigging Old Wells. Redigging Old Wells. Sounds like an awesome topic. Redigging the Old Wells. That's going to be, the first class is this Friday. This Friday at 6:30 p.m. In trailer number 2. It's going to be over in the trailer. So trailer number 2, 6:30 p.m. with Shirley Hilton. And I believe we're ready for worship. Are you guys ready? Amen. Oh, we have one more announcement. I'm sorry.
Good morning. I'm Barbara Kershey. I'm the leader of the Young at Heart group here at the church. And we sponsor the Seder Supper each year. And for those of you that may or may not understand what the Seder is, Seder comes... The word Seder literally means order. It's God's order. And God commanded and instructed the children of Israel to follow feasts during the year. And the two major feasts that he instructed them to follow are the Sabbath and the Passover. And the Seder is the Passover feast. We will be celebrating the Seder on March the 24th here at the church. And we have a very special guest that's going to be here to lead our Seder. Rabbi Ron Aronson is going to be with us, and it will be phenomenal. I really encourage you to come. There's a flyer that has more information at the back. I'll be at the back to have everybody sign up. The Seder foods and a full meal are all provided during this, so there is a cost. But we need a head count because there's a lot of preparation and we have to do that. Sign up will be this Sunday, next Sunday, and we have to have everything in by the end of the month so we can be ready for the 24th.
I just want to remind everyone that we are so blessed with all the different opportunities that we have at our church. And one of those is we have an exercise class for ladies only. And it is amazing, amazing, amazing. My 21-year-old daughter went to it and she said, "Mom, I thought this was going to be a piece of cake." She said, "It was incredible." So ladies, what's so beautiful about this class is they're not just exercising, but they're developing camaraderie and unity and fellowshipping together. It's such a sweet class. Elizabeth, will you stand? This is Elizabeth Pitcher who leads it. She is so awesome. And if you want to look like Elizabeth, da-da-dum, come to the class. It's Mondays at 6:30.
Are we ready? I mean, why don't you stand?
Thank you. church. We believe in the resurrection life. New heaven. Yeah.
to make your praise glorious.
Worthy of praise, Lord God.
Spirit,
Holy Spirit, come. Yes,
let it
let it fall down. Let it fall down. Holy Spirit,
yes.
Come. Holy Spirit, move. Come and take your rightful place in us. Holy Spirit, come.
Come and take.
Come and take your rightful place. Holy Spirit, come.
That is our prayer, Lord. It's not by power nor might, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord. And we need you in every area of our life, Lord God. Be our teacher, be our helper. Lord, may our heart and our mind, our will be submitted to yours. You are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And you have given us your word and you have given us your presence. We are not without, Lord God, but we are fully furnished by your Holy Spirit. And we thank you for it. And we welcome you here today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Why don't you be seated?
Wow, that's awesome. We're going to take communion.
Amen.
And just encourage you, just as we've done it in the past, we're going to have our elders come, and they're going to partake, and they're going to serve. And then the ushers will direct you. But I just encourage you, this is Valentine's Day, right? Hey, I encourage the men in the first service, if you've kind of messed up and forgotten, you know, somewhere in the sermon, it'll be all right. Just act like you're sick at your stomach and got to step out, go take care of business, okay? Don't be empty-handed today. Oh, pray that you already did that, amen. 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 And guys, it's Valentine's all day, all day. I won't tell you what I do because the men's prayer asked me not to share what I do. But anyhow, it's Valentine's all day, right? And but I ask you, as you take communion, this is that moment where you get to focus in on you. And it's not out of self-centeredness, but out of inspection. You say, Lord, try me, know me, search me. Yes. So we don't even know our own hearts. And just ask the Lord to show you things and just lay everything that you got, every struggle, every trial, every burden, everything that's preoccupying your mind, lay it down at the cross today. And that's what he died for. And so as you partake, I'd ask dads, husbands, lead out today. And if you're here and you're alone, if you see somebody by themselves, grab them up. Bring them into your group. We always look for people to grab up into our group, and because we're all family. We don't want anybody doing this by yourself. And we're all brothers and sisters in the Lord here. And let's just partake together. Amen.
name of Jesus, nothing shall stand. Every knee shall bow in his presence. In the name of Jesus, our tongue shall confess and bow down to the power of his holiness. In the name of Jesus, nothing shall stand. Every knee shall bow in his presence. In the name of Jesus, our tongue shall confess and bow down to the power of his holiness. The Lord is great and greatly to be praised, for he has given life through the power of his name. In the name of Jesus, nothing shall stand. Every knee shall bow in his presence. In the name of Jesus, our tongue shall confess and bow down to the power of his holiness. Oh, holy, you, O Lord, are holy. Holy, holy, you, O Lord, are holy. Sing that again. Just stand and sing with us, holy. Falling down. worship you. Worthy of praise, oh God. Holy, holy, holy. God in three persons, blessed Trinity.
I always love to sing this part. Perfect,
perfect in power and love and purity. God in three persons, blessed Trinity.
Lord, as we took communion today, Lord, I just thank you, Lord, for your blood.
Yes.
I thank you for that holy, pure blood. That it wasn't by the shedding of blood that we have the forgiveness of sin. And Lord, for every one of us right where we're at, you meet us right where we're at. Lord, I can even come before you, and holy, holy, holy God, and say, Lord, search me, try me. Know my heart. And Lord, even when I come to you as we were partaking, that there are some things I come before you and I know about my heart, and yet you still receive me and you love me, and I thank you. Your grace and your mercy, it has no end. It's beautiful, it's deep, it's wide, and it's eternal. And we thank you, Father. It's unconditional love. For God so loved the world, he sent Jesus. And we thank you, Jesus, for what you did for us upon that cross. And we thank you. You've not left us alone. He said, I go to the Father so that the Helper might come. And here we are in this moment, able to cry out, Holy Spirit, help us. Holy Spirit, teach us. Holy Spirit, show us. And we invite you, Holy Spirit, in this place, in this moment, intervene and interrupt. Do what you must do. We need you, not by power nor might, but by my Spirit. And we thank you for your love. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Won't you be seated?
Good morning. Tomorrow night at 7 o'clock in room 1, we are going to be having a Ministry of Helps meeting. This group has been such a blessing to the pastors at this church. This Ministry of Helps groups gives and gives to so many of the people in our church that are going through. There are people right now you may not be aware of, but they're not here today because they're going through. They've been in the hospital this week. They're going through overcoming cancer. And the bottom line is, ladies and gentlemen, is there's not enough pastors at this church to take care of all these people. And the Ministry of Helps loves on these people, whether it's through a phone call or taking them to the hospital or just going by and visiting them. So if that's in your heart, I would love for you to come tomorrow night in Room 1, Leonel and Reuben and Shirley Hilton oversee this group and have done an amazing job. So thank all of you who are involved in this group.
Oh, wow, that was awesome. I love that song, Holy, Holy, Holy. One small Bible fact, I guess, is in the Hebrew language, they don't have any exclamation points, right? So the way that they make their exclamation points is by repeating the same word over and over. So when they say, holy, 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 they're really shouting, holy, holy. They're really shouting that out. And it just brings to mind, you know, that verse, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. And the question is whether you're going to do that now or do that later. Whether you believe or not, you're going to do it. And just that song brings all that stuff to mind, so I just love it. I would like to recognize our first or second time visitors. If you're visiting with us for the very first or second time, would you please stand up so that we can recognize you guys? We have a small gift basket for you in there. Welcome, 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 guys. Welcome, welcome. And in the bag, there is an information card that if you fill out and bring to the back to the information table, we have a little something for you from Chick-fil-A because we just want to love on you guys. And we saw your faces, so everyone, the challenge is to give them a hug before they leave here today. Okay, love you guys.
Praise God. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
I don't have a joke this morning, unless you consider me standing here. Wow. Thank you, Annabelle.
A little help.
Sacrifice. This is what the Lord put on my heart this morning. Sacrifice. You know what the meaning of sacrifice is? It means to give something good so that you can get something better. That's literally the definition of sacrifice. And I think a lot of churches, ministers, and so forth, have jumped onto that and talk about giving sacrificially so that you can pocket it. But that's not always what that means. It's not necessarily untrue, but it's not necessarily true either. Think of an athlete. An athlete, a football player, starts with two-a-day, sometimes three-a-days, as the coach is a real maniac. In August, and they just go through everything that there is to go through, and they just sacrifice and sacrifice and sacrifice their bodies to create excellence. And the payoff may not be till December in a championship game. And what are they going through all that for? To become excellent. So there wasn't any monetary reasons for going through all that. And I ask you right now, when you sacrifice, when you give, which is to give something good, your expectation is to get something better. It's not necessarily money. And let me tell you about the ultimate sacrifice. It said, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. God sacrificed his son. And then it came on my heart. What was the something better? God gave, sacrificed his son. And it dawned on me. It was a relationship with me. God valued his relationship with us, you individually. If I was the only person, he would have sacrificed his son to have a relationship with me. Praise God. Lord, I thank you so very much that you gave and you thought so much of us, that you loved your creation and you wanted a relationship with us, oh God. And now, Lord, we have an opportunity to give back to you, to sacrifice back unto you, Lord. Father God, I know that the something better is the character that you are building in our church and the people here, the families, the koinonia. Lord, I thank you for all those things. Now, I bless every person here that's giving. Thank you for their sacrifice of giving. Bless it. May it go three times as far because your hand is in the middle of it. In your precious name, amen.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. And I'm accepted. You were condemned. And I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Sing it again. And I'm forgiven, because you were forsaken, I'm accepted. You were condemned, and I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Amazing love. Amazing love. How can it be that you, my King, would die for me? It's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Well, and your spirit is within me because you died and rose again.
Come on, stand up and sing that.
Amazing love, amazing love. How can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love. all I do. I honor you in all I do. I honor you. I honor you. Yes, we do. I honor you, yes, Lord. I honor you.
We do, Father, worship you. Worthy of praise. Worthy of praise. And we have so much to be thankful for, Lord. So much to rejoice over. How faithful you are, Lord God. Lord, how mighty you are. How constant you are. How sure you are, Lord, to our lives. You're a rock, a fortress, Lord, to our heart and our mind and our soul. And we thank you for Jesus. And we thank you, Holy Spirit, for all your help. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Why don't you be seated? Amen.
I'm going to take just a few moments. I got Larson. Come here. He's been busting out of the seams to share. Amen. And just to glorify the Lord, what the Lord's done in his life. And I had put him off because we had a lot of things crammed in. It made us run over a little bit this morning, but that's okay. You know, just to allow him the opportunity to get out what's in his heart. And just like I had to do last week, right? I had to do that. And the Lord is glorified by that. So why don't you share?
I showed you this morning is my father. One day he says, "Come here, son." So I didn't know what he wanted. He wanted to explain me, tell me about him and mama. They were expecting a child. They didn't know who or what. See, so she says it's getting close. Did you ask one of those men who could help us in case we need some help? He says, "I'm going to ask." He asked, and they directed him. He come back home. He says, "I don't trust that white woman. What are you going to do?" Well, he says, see that road in front here? That black woman that goes up and down here? He says, "I'm going to go ask her. If she could come help us." So he went. He knocked on the door. He asked her. She says, "Whenever it's time, just come and get me." So time was there, see, so the white lady was there. So he says, "I'm going to get that black lady, see, over there, see, and bring her here. In case we should need her, near her." When she got there, he put a chair on by the bed. And he says, "Your job is to watch that boy." So about 2 minutes later, she says, "Mr. LeBlanc, look. He's turning blue. You have anything white?" So he pulled out his knife. Cut the corner of the sheet. He said, "Don't worry, she'll sew that letter." She put that over me and gave me her breath. This is one time, this is why I'm standing here. Then there had many things that happened to me, see, during my lifetime. I give this instance. So one day they had given me the job of being a salesman. I seen at a wholesale where I was working. And I was coming back, it was dark. And there was a horse running alongside the road. I didn't know if he was inside or on the outside. And I heard a voice. What would you do if that horse would cross the road in front of you? I was doing about 75 miles an hour. I slowed down to 35 until I crossed over, passed the horse up. See, then, let's see, one of them, one day, see, I was working at a fabricating plant, and they didn't have any more work for more than 8 hours a day. So I said I'd go work at the shipyard. I went to the shipyard, and they hired me, see, to work at least 5 hours a day. There was a young man there, a Spanish guy. So that was on a Friday. I said, tomorrow, I said, I'm going to Louisiana to see my daughters in Louisiana. He says, can I ride with you? I said, sure, come on. So I brought them with me. I saw my girls. I went and eat with them. And on the way back, we stopped at a lounge. And we were having a couple of beers. And I was about this much left in my bottle. I said, well, before we leave, since I have to go to the bathroom. So I come back, drank that beer, and he had put a Mickey in it. Before I could do a half a mile, I was sleepy. So I told him, I said, I pulled in at that parking lot that they had just on the side, just on the other side of that signal lot that I went through. I said, help me get in the back seat and sleep. Okay? I'm too sleepy. So he did. I said, now you drive to Houston. Instead of driving to Houston, he took a side road and went to a wooded area. And there, see, he found out that I had a gun in my glove box. So I don't know if he pulled me out of the car or what. He probably did. See, told me that story after, see. And he said, I took the gun and 3 bullets, not a one of them went out of the chambers. Then he said, I am at a tree, and all 3 of them went into the tree.
Hold on, Lawson. Part of what he's wanting to share with you is he's gone through cancer. And what he's trying to say is that everything in his life, the Lord has protected him, brought him through, had his back. And that's true for all of us. Amen. And even in this area of his life, and some of those things, if he just hadn't listened to what the Holy Spirit was saying, it's a matter of life and death.
That's right.
And even for his cancer, the Lord, in this process of cancer, has given him some wisdom of what brought that upon him and how to overcome that. And the Lord's been faithful. And he wanted to just to glorify the Lord in that. And I want us to pray for him right now, if you would agree with me. Father, we lift up Larson to you, Father, and just thank you for his life. Lord, from the cradle, Lord, every step of his way, Father, you've guided his steps and watched over him, Father. Lord, you've looked out for him even when he was unconscious, Lord God. You had his back. Lord, even when his own heart was wayward and maybe not in line with you, still you were guiding him and watching over him and bringing him, Father, to you. And Father, to use him, Lord, as we talked last week, Lord, to comfort others in the same comfort of which he's been comforted with, Lord. And that's what his life has been about. And even now, Father, that he's comforting others, that the Lord is his healer and the Lord is his strength and the Lord is faithful and the Lord is good. And Lord, that you have been with him throughout all of his life. We give you the praise and the glory for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Valentine's Day. Happy Valentine's. If you missed our sweetheart banquet, you missed it. Because we didn't document it. Oh, we had a blast. We really did. Just laughing and, you know, a lot of the songs that we grew up listening to that, you know, we mark time with a lot of the songs that we hear, and you know, you might have your theme song from when you were dating and engaged and married, and sometimes that even changes over time. The Lord gives you new songs, and so we just had a blast. We got some characters in this church, amen. We got some talent in this church too, amen. It was a blast. I mean, the Stafford Center had nothing on us last night or Friday night. It was awesome. And so I wanted today to kick off probably what would be a series, and I was just going to call the series, He's from Dirt and She's from Bone. Oh, you got another one? Did y'all catch that? He's from dirt. She's from bone. It's kind of like, you know, you're not from Venus and Mars. I'm sorry, that guy got it wrong. Guys are from dirt. It's as scriptural as we can get. And by the way, I think I saw our good buddy over there, which his name just went out of my Nash, Bill Nash. Bill Nash is with us this morning. I was looking to my left, and boom, there he was. Hey, good to have you. But I think that's significant to point out in Scripture that man and the woman are not from the same origin, which means that we're different, right? That's going to help us understand ourselves a little bit better. And we're going to walk through a couple things. Today, what we've got to do is just marriage 101. I got to talk about biblically the stance of marriage. Marriage is the between a man and a woman, nothing else. Sorry. And that sex is only for marriage. Hello. And shacking up and living together, that's man's reasoning. That's not a biblical. That's turning your back on marriage, actually. And we'll look at that. And let me just say, let me preface it this way. Because I'm not trying to be ugly. I'm not. You know, just because I say the truth doesn't mean I love you. Actually, it means I do love you. Because it'd be a whole lot more convenient for me to give you a little feel-good message, and maybe the offering will be even better. Hallelujah. Right. But that's not what God called me to do.
And it reminds me of a story. I was growing up, you know, grew up singing gospel music, and we made 5 records, 8-track tapes, all that good stuff, you know. Sang at churches all the time. That was kind of my family's recreation, was going to churches and singing gospel music. And we did revivals and church meetings, and I've heard more preaching probably you can imagine in my lifetime. Heard some good preaching, heard some not so good preaching, but heard a lot of good preaching. Heard a lot of great preachers in my lifetime. And there was, you know, this is before internet, before Facebook and all this. This is back in the 70s, and I don't know quite how it would happen, but you'd have these certain stories that would circulate through these different preachers, and you'd go to these different churches and wind up hearing the same illustration. And there's this illustration that kept getting passed around, and it was kind of told as if it was true. I don't know if it's true or not. It's kind of like this other preacher I heard one time. His name was Curtis Mathis. Now, for the older folks in the house, I'm not talking about the TV. You know, the TVs that used to look like furniture, Curtis Mathis. That was his name, Curtis Mathis. And he was sitting there saying that one day he was preaching, and he told this story, and it was a real off-the-wall story. And afterwards, he got with his daughter, his granddaughter sitting on his lap after church, and said, "Grandpa, was that story true?" And he goes, "Well, oh, no, baby, really, I was just preaching." Well, later on, he's telling his daughter something true and factual, and the granddaughter looks at him and says, "Grandpa, are you telling the truth or are you just preaching?" Yeah, you know. So I don't know if these guys sharing this story I'm about to tell you are telling the truth or just preaching, but here's the story. There was a young man. He came out of seminary, and he's fresh out of seminary looking for a pulpit. And this is the old Baptist days, you know, where you the church that's looking for a preacher has a pulpit committee, got a chairman of the pulpit committee. They'll even go visit another church to hear him preach. And if they're interested in him, they'll have a little vote and say, "Let's bring him in." And they'll bring him into the church, and they call it in view of a call. So he's coming to preach in view of a call so that everybody can hear him preach. And then the pulpit committee will decide whether or not we want to submit his name as a candidate for being pastor of this church. And then the whole church body would vote on it. Well, he comes in view of a call, and he's going to give his best message. Man, he's just letting them have it on sin and heaven and hell. And he's going at it, and he gets so caught up in it. At some point, he just drops out this big old expletive right in the middle of his message. And so he just gets to this point where he just brings it to a quick close, shuts his Bible, says a little prayer, and just quietly walks on out the sanctuary. He feels, I'm done, you know. Well, and he walks out. The chairman of the pulpit committee comes up and says to the church membership, says, "Folks, I don't know about you, but if this man's that mad at the devil, then that's the guy we need for this church." And they hired him. Right? And there is a lot of truth to that. I'm not saying let's get to expletives, but you go back to John, and you go to John 11, when Jesus comes to heal Lazarus, and it says that he's troubled in spirit, it says. And that Greek word that says he was troubled in spirit means that the Greek word is like a horse. When you see a horse, it's either stomping the ground because he's scared, or he's stomping the ground because he's angry. Well, we know Jesus didn't have a spirit of fear. So Jesus is stomping the ground because he's angry. And I don't think, because the following verse says Jesus wept, then the following verse says that it was obvious to everybody around that Jesus loved Mary, Martha, and Lazarus very much. So I don't buy that traditional view that he was angry at their littleness of faith. He already knew about their littleness of faith. That's why he let them die and go into the grave so that he could glorify God and bring them on out. I think what he was upset at is seeing the effects and the works of the enemy on his creation, on his people. And that's why the first thing that Jesus declared, we talked about this a couple weeks ago, that statement that he made, that baptismal statement that he's come to destroy the works of the devil. And what he read out of Isaiah was that he's come to set the captives free. And he's come to undo those chains that bind them. And so you can't do that without truth, folks. It's the truth that shall set you free. And so when I talk about hard things, I'm not talking about it to be judgmental. I'm looking at people that the enemy has just twisted up and deceived, and they don't know the truth. They don't know the truth. And I want them to. And that's my approach. That's why I'm going to share what I'm going to share, because I can't talk to you about the love languages, and I can't talk to you about behavioral things and how to learn your wife and for the wife to learn their husband and how to use the Holy Spirit in that if we don't understand the very beginning that God designed marriage. It wasn't your idea. It wasn't any man's on earth's idea. It was God's idea. He designed it. He set the parameters for it. He said it's a man and a woman, and that intimacy, that physical intimacy, is only for that man and the woman within the confines of marriage. That's his parameters. That's his rules. That's how he's designed it. And if we don't understand that, it doesn't matter what I tell you that follows. It really doesn't. You've got to understand that. So my goal here is that when we walk out of here today, that you commit yourself to be as serious about marriage as God is. Not me, because I want to increase as well. There's still room for me to grow. And I want every one of us to be as committed and passionate about marriage as God is. That's the goal. Well, let's get started. Genesis 2, 4 through 7. Genesis 2, 4 through 7. Some of these passages are the passages I always use when I do a wedding ceremony. Genesis 2, 4, 7 gives us this account. It says, "This is the account of the heavens and the earth when they were created. In the day that the Lord God made earth and heaven, now no shrub of the field was yet in the earth, and no plant of the field had yet sprouted, for the Lord God had not sent rain upon the earth, and there was no man to cultivate the ground." Now, you got to understand, just from that passage, we get a little messed up in our culture here and all the politics that we hear. I want you to understand that the earth was not created, you were not created for the earth. The earth was created for you. It was created for you. Matter of fact, even after God went through all this of creating the earth, not anything even grew. There were no water even fell because there was not yet a man to cultivate it. It was all created. It was his habitat. All the resources were there for him. And guess what? He didn't create man to walk around with entitlement. You know, just because this is before the fall doesn't mean that Adam didn't work. He certainly did. He cultivated. He planted him in the Garden of Eden to cultivate what was there. But this is what it means. Before the fall, he operated in an anointing for that purpose, which means that he didn't get blisters on his hands. It wasn't a struggle for him. Just, you know, when you walk in the anointing, things aren't a struggle. Matter of fact, when you walk in the anointing, it might be something that you're doing that's difficult, and other people look at you and say, "Wow, he makes that look easy." Well, that's because he's not doing it by himself. He's operating in the anointing. And that's what God created the heaven and the earth for Adam to walk in his anointing to cultivate the earth. The earth was designed and built to be occupied by man, and for man to be creative within it and to cultivate. That's the purpose. So he creates the heavens, he creates the earth, and it says he had sent no rain upon the earth. There was no man to cultivate the ground, but a mist used to rise from the earth and water the whole surface of the ground. Then the Lord God formed man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. That's how it began. That's the beginning. I don't care what you think about evolution or anything else. It's just like we talked about that miracle of Jesus turning the water into wine. And my own son at the age of 15 had enough sense to realize that that wine that he created was a mature, aged wine. And he did it instantaneously. And he was able to parallel that to God's creation, where we can't wrap our brain around 6 days and we can look at all the science and can't figure it out, that God's fully capable of creating a mature, aged earth instantaneously. Now, it's impossible to him. He's not stuck in the realm of time. I have no idea where I'm at. This is burning in my heart. We see, even at the fall of man, what happened for the fall of man, the task of cultivating didn't change for him, but now he's lost the anointing to do it. Because now you see, he says to the woman, he says, "Now when you give birth, you're going to give birth with pain." And then he goes to the man and he says to the man, "Now when you work the earth and you cultivate the earth, it's going to be just as the woman experiences pain, it's going to be painful for you." There will be toil with it. There will be flesh involved trying to accomplish what's in your heart to accomplish because of the fall. We experienced that. Well, that was the part of the fall. But just before that occurred in chapter 3, you have this continuation of the creation of man. In Genesis 2, 15, God wants to show Adam something else. Not only do you need the anointing to fulfill your purpose on the earth, but you're still lacking something. Now, Adam doesn't know it yet. Now, I got a feeling Adam was probably lonely, because we're going to see why here in a minute. It's built within his design. He couldn't help but feel lonely. He had something already churning in him, but he didn't understand why yet. And I think God purposely delayed this because he wants to school Adam. And that's what he's fixing to do. Adam's fixing to have marriage 101. He's fixing to be taught what's going on within his heart. It says, then the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to cultivate it and to keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, from any tree of the garden you may eat freely. But from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat from it, for in the day that you eat from it, you shall surely die. Now, I love that because that is God speaking to a man and speaking a man's language, right? He gives him this great creation, and he doesn't give him a bunch of verbiage. He doesn't give him some dotted line to have to read. Small print. He just gives him real simple instructions. I'm going to put you in here to cultivate this place, and you can eat anything you want to in here. Just stay away from that tree in the middle. Stay away from that tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Simple. We like that, don't we, guys? It's good stuff. Set a parameter for him. Now, let's just take note that that parameter was set and given and commissioned to Adam to keep, and Eve's not even on the scene yet. Because now we see in 18, then the Lord God said, it's not good for the man to be alone. Now, this is kind of where we're going to, we want to look at the differences between a man and a woman. This is the first difference, women, you need to understand. It's not good for a man to be alone. Now, don't think we're shallow just because it's not good for a man to be alone. But that's in our design. It's within us. God recognized that in the very beginning of creation, where he's created man. He knows within his design his own limitations within him. And this is an unfallen being that he's created. And yet he knows within his design there's still something lacking. He needs something else. But I need him to learn that there's something lacking and he needs something else. So it says, it's not good for the man to be alone. I will make him a helper suitable for him. Out of the ground the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every bird of the sky and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called a living creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all the cattle and to the birds of the sky and every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found a helper suitable for him. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. And then he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh at that place. And then the Lord God fashioned into a woman the rib which he had taken from the man and brought her to the man. And the man said, I think I first would have said, whoa, man. I just love that name. Whoa, man. Woo. He says, this is now bone of my bones. He's actually right now operating in some heiress love. He sees her, and he likes what he sees. And he says, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman. Woman. Because she was taken out of man. It really is like the form of man with a womb. Ability to recreate. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and his mother. Here it is. This is marriage right here. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and his mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. I want you to understand the first thing about this, because there is an alarming statistic, and I'll get to that in just a little bit, but of people that are forsaking marriage and having all the reasons why they would forsake marriage. But here we see this is a public event. This isn't a private event. This is God joining them together before all creation. He brought all creation into this picture. And before all creation and before God, he joins them together. He creates her, fashions her, and then he says, wow, she's bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. He's excited. It's a beautiful picture. I want you also to notice something. Because you go to chapter 3 and we see the fall that took place. And I want you to understand, yeah, God went to Eve first and God confronted Eve with what took place. But I want you to notice where the buck stopped. The last conversation was with her husband. The last conversation was with Adam. And Adam didn't do his job. See, part of what takes place for us as men, guys, you're the doorkeeper. That mug we gave you on Father's Day, if you don't got one, we'll get you one. You're the doorkeeper. Every time you drink that coffee or whatever you drink, drink it out of that cup and look at that verse and look at that key. You're the doorkeeper. When I lay in bed at night and I might ask my kids, I might be bone tired, and I'll say, would you please check the front door and the back door for me? And they going upstairs, I'll lay in that bed and can't go to sleep because I didn't check it. I have to get up and go and jiggle. And sometimes if I'm real tired, I might have made it halfway down the hallway and say, I'm not sure if I checked that. And go back here and check it two or three times before I get in bed. And then lay in bed and say, Lord God, when I go to sleep here, I'm going to be unconscious. And really, I can't protect this place while I'm asleep. Lord, protect my home. That's the men's job. That's why the buck stopped with the man. That's why God went and had the last conversation with him. Because that mandate, that parameter that was given to protect that place was given to Adam and not to Eve. Well, that's just extra. I'm going to move through some of this. I want to get to the unveiling need. Because what God did was unveil a need in Adam's life. I use that passage every time I do a wedding. I want them to understand that. I want them to be aware. And I'll just say this. It's probably part that I'm skipping. But we must be aware of our differences. Because, guys, I say this carefully. Because it's good to read books. I love the five love languages. I love a lot of those books to give us help. All those things are there for a reason. But you have to be careful. And sometimes I think the ladies get a little more messed up in this than the guys do sometimes when you read the book and you think, okay, I got them figured out now. You ain't never going to figure me out. I know I'm never going to figure her out. I can educate myself, try to understand the differences. But even though I'm aware of the differences, when she does some of the things she does or processes and says some things she says, I still don't understand it. I'm not going to. That's what kind of creates the conflict. But that's the beauty. She's different than me. She didn't come from the same origin of me. But I need her. And that's what God was showing Adam. You need her. She makes you complete. I bring my wife into our pastor's meetings when we have those because I tell the guys, here's three guys standing here, and I say, I'm bringing her in because she's got a little bit different vision than we do. And she might see something here we don't see just because we're different. That's the way it should be. That's my wife helping me. I need her. Couldn't do this, believe me. You can't do this job without being complete. I'll explain some of that later. This unveiling of need. God, in all of his knowingness, he also states this. He says, it's not good for man to be alone. And I said that, you know, gals don't think of us as shallow because, yeah, probably one of the first things on a guy's mind is that physical thing. It's not good for a man to be alone. I don't have to go into details. You know what I'm talking about, right? But it's more than that. I can't function without her. I need her to complete me. There's also that need that's not good for me to be alone because I'm not a whole man as I need to be without her in my life. I need her. And God, in all of his knowingness, he knew that. It's within our design. So God schools Adam. He takes every animal that's been created, both male and female, and it's with this whole thing is already in the design of creation. But Adam just doesn't see it yet. It's already there. And he begins to bring these animals, what? Male and female. There were no pairs of male. There were no pairs of female. You wouldn't think that I'd need to say that, but we do. This design is God's, not the Supreme Court's. This design is God's, not we the people. Sorry. This design is God's, not the world. We must know what God says concerning it. And right there in creation, you see, he unveils this by these pairs walking up, male and female. And it doesn't take long as Adam's seeing them come through. And he goes, oh, look at that. It's covered with all that hair. Oh, I think I'll call it a bear. That was a Bob Dylan lyric, if you caught on to that. God, a man gave names to all the animals in the beginning, long time ago. You ever heard that? Come on, some of you had heard that. Any Bob Dylan fans out there? He did have a born-again era. He did. In the 70s, he made about 3 albums. I'm going to tell you, if you go listen to them, God had to do something in his heart for him to write those songs. But right there in creation, it's revealed. As these pairs come before Adam, he begins to get it. And he goes to God, says, God, all your creation, they have another half. They have something that completes them. I don't have that. I don't have it. And so God says, all right, now we're ready. He's got it. He understands that longing. He understands that need. I'm going to put him to sleep, and I'm going to draw from him that bone, and out of that bone, I'm going to fashion this woman. And that, my friends, is the history of how marriage began. It was God's idea. It was God's plan. It was God's design. And with that design, he's the one that set the parameters to it, and no one else. I was looking at a Gallup poll this weekend, and it was talking about our 20-somethings and our 30-somethings within our culture and how there is a large number, and there's been a rise from decade to decade, but particularly the 30-somethings that are present now, there is a large group, a large percentage of them that are living together and not getting married. And that's alarming enough, right? But there's also this group of 20-somethings, and there's a different trend that has greatly increased within the 20-somethings in that they're not getting married and they're not living with anybody. Now, that seems a little strange, doesn't it? You might, on the surface, say, well, that sounds like good news, but it's not, because their sexual activity is highly increased, and they do it for recreation or to fulfill a need, and the partner is not that significant and not that important. So what does that mean? Well, at least in the 30-somethings, speaking of the 30s age, you got those groups that at least are in some kind of committed relationship, even though they've not gotten married. But the 20-somethings aren't committing to any relationship. So you know what they call that? It's a progression of sin. That's what it is. It's a progression of sin. Not saying that to be ugly, but that's how sin works. And there's many reasons, even just with the living together, why people would do that. You know, they'll say, well, it's an easier way to learn if you're compatible with the legal, instead of the legal bind of marriage. And, well, yeah, so what? Easier to dissolve the relationship should it prove to work out, or should it prove to not work out. You have some that'll just say, well, we don't need a piece of paper, we don't need a ceremony, and we're already one fleshed. There are some that may say, and you see this even with folks in their 50s and 60s, that it might be for financial reasons, some status that they have financially. They're willing to live with the person and not be married because they don't want to lose the money. I'm just telling you. But you can go through any of those things, and I'm going to tell you, all that is reasoning of man. It has nothing to do with Scripture. Nothing to do with Scripture. It's just like Eve sitting here with the devil. And she's been told, she knows she's not supposed to eat of it. And yet the devil's sitting over here taking Scripture and twisting Scripture and getting her to reason why it'll be okay. Well, God just really don't mean to do it because I'm going to be like him. So, it's not that big of a deal. And eats of the tree. And look at the mess we're in. You see what reasoning like that will do. Because it doesn't matter the reasoning. What it matters is the truth. Folks, it's the truth that will set you free, not your reasoning. You go through Proverbs, there's a reason why it says there's a way that seems right to a man and the end of it's death, and it says it several times throughout Proverbs because it wants you to get it. You can't reason your way through this. I usually tell folks that we counsel either going through contemplating divorce or in this kind of a situation, I just always tell them, okay, I'll tell you what. Take this Bible and go reconcile your reasoning with Scripture and then come back and let's talk about it. And they never do because they can't. They can't. And see, the world works opposite. I didn't mean to share this, but I'll do it just so you understand what I'm saying. Sam Houston, I was supposed to take a course, but my counselor was not there. He was sick, and I couldn't get to see him. And so they told me to go to this other counselor, and I didn't have enough forethought as a young man to look up there and realize that he only had his undergraduates in music, but his master's and his doctorates were in philosophy. And so he's sitting there counseling me, and he says, you know what, you can substitute this class because you can't get it right now. It's filled up, but you can substitute this class with this philosophy class. I get in this philosophy class. It's a 400-level philosophy class. I've never had any philosophy. Man, I was sunk. I get into this class, and the professor says, you know, you're sitting here talking about capital punishment, abortion, right to life, all these different issues. And he says to us on our test, which is all essay, says on the test, you can't use Scripture. Don't use the Bible. If you use the Bible, I'm going to X your paper out. So I get in there, and I'm having to talk about, you know, right to life and capital punishment and these things. And what did I do? I used Scripture. And guess what I got? A 35. Only four major grades in this whole semester. Four tests, three within the semester and a final. And I'm starting out with a 35. But I was irritated and determined I ain't quitting. And I never read so much in my life trying to keep up and catch up with these guys in this 400-level class. And I learned to vocalize my opinion without using Scripture, but in a roundabout way, still talking about the things of God. Because when I talked about capital punishment, I actually had worked some executions. I was fully aware. I had some inside knowledge of that. But I was also aware of this. My Savior, Lord Jesus Christ, redeemed me through capital punishment. And I just began to talk about that. I didn't use one Scripture. Wasn't a thing he could do about it. I wound up passing that class with a C. But you see what the world wants to do. It says, no, we don't want any of that Scripture. No, we don't want the Bible. No, we don't want any authority in our life. No, we don't want to know the bottom line and what it says in black and white. We'll just go with our reasoning. But there's a way that seems right unto a man in the end of his death. And folks, there's just a lot of marriages that are drowning, that are suffering. And the enemy's having a field day with it. And it's in the church as well as outside the church. I'm going to give you a couple of big biblical pictures of public marriage. This arrangement for Adam that we talked about here, it was public. All creation was standing there when God did that. It was instituted. Marriage was instituted publicly in that moment, biblically. Jesus in Matthew 19, 4-6, recounts that same account of creation. And with it, he includes this: what God has joined together, let no man separate. And you know what that means? It would be like I took my wife's heart, and I took my heart, and I took a big old tube of super glue, and I sprayed it all over both hearts, and zoom, pushed them together. Bonded. Inseparable. That's what that means. Glued together. Bonded and inseparable. What God has joined together, let no man separate. That's what it means. God made a public event of drawing Adam to a place of awareness with Eve and creating Eve for him. And you got Genesis 29, 22. Here's Jacob. Jacob sees Rachel, and she looked good to him. He had some heiress love just pounding in his heart. He knew it was not good for man to be alone. He had that driving him to that place to find his wife. And when he sees her, he goes to Laban, her father, And he asked for her to marry her. And guys, it wasn't a shack up. This was going to turn into an event, a celebration. Of course, the dad deceived him and gave him her, Rachel's sister. But the point is, it says in 29:22, Laban gathered all the men of the place and they made a feast. It was public. It was event. It was celebrated before all men and before God. That, my friends, is woven in God's culture and in God's people. You look at John 2, 1 through 2. Just referenced it a moment ago. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there, and both Jesus and his disciples were invited to the wedding. Now, when I see that, I just paid for one, okay? And I see that, and both Jesus and his disciples were invited to it, which means they went out and hired a rabbi, they went out and rented a venue, and they sent out invitations, and even Jesus and his disciples got them, right? A public event. Marriage was intended to be celebrated that way and to be done in public and before the people. God and people. Why? I always tell every wedding I do, that I tell the crowd before I tell them sit down, I say, you're just as important to this process as anything because you're witnesses to the vows that they're about to share. You're the ones that are friends and neighbors that are going to hold them accountable when things are going rough. You're the ones that are going to remind them of the words they said when they exchanged this ring. It's public. There's a reason for it. Of course, we see, you know, even in this one, just like you do, you send out an invitation, and what happens? You wind up with more guests than you invited. You run out of resources. They ran out of wine. And that's the first major miracle of Jesus at a wedding. And he turns water into wine. Wedding, public event, honoring God. That's what it's supposed to be like. You even see this word right here. From the beginning, we've already looked at it, Genesis, weaving through the scriptures, going to Revelations. We see a church who's the bride of Christ. We see a church, and all of this mess culminates to a beautiful wedding, a beautiful dinner, an event. A festival, a feast that's celebrating the same picture. You look at Paul's writings, many times he would start talking about the relationship between a man and a woman, and he's saying, I'm not even talking about marriage, I'm talking about the church. Because it is interwoven in that word throughout it. Why? Because it was his idea. It was his design. Came from his thoughts. Came from his mind. I want to talk about the progression of our sins. As I mentioned in that survey, those that are in their 30s that statistically preferring to live together, but yet you see in those in their 20s this trend of not even deciding to live together, but deciding to remain single, but yet still sexually active and enjoying all the benefits of what a married couple would experience, but outside the commitment and the bonds of matrimony. They're going to just, you're going to use that to fulfill their needs or to recreate, whichever. But that's the culture that we see. That's the trend that we see. And in that survey, we saw that commitment, that relationships are deteriorating, and we see that there is a forsaking of marriage. And folks, I'm just telling you, you do not want to jack with marriage. That's a nice way of saying it. Don't mess with it. Marriage, divorce, you know, sex outside of marriage, all of these things, we got to base it upon the Word of God, upon His heart, upon His mind, and not upon our reasoning. And I could go on and on. I could go for weeks talking about marriage, talking about just the biblical. It's interwoven through this so many times. I guarantee you, if I can teach on John for 50 weeks and only be in chapter 12, I guarantee you, for marriage, it's interwoven from the beginning to the end. I could spend a long time just talking about it and spend a long time talking about how sex outside of marriage is a sin. You go through the law, look through the laws and what the consequences were for sex outside of marriage. It was severe. I didn't mess around with it. That came out of God's design as well. He didn't change. So I'm telling you this, guys. because I can't move forward until I know, and this is what I'm going to ask you to do, every one of you that are married in this place, and every one of you who are contemplating it, or every one of you that's in a relationship and you're not married, but maybe you're moving that direction or should be, I'm going to want you to make a commitment today with me. You know, choose this day in whom you shall serve is what I'm saying. And that you'll choose this day to make marriage passionate in your heart. That you'll be a fighter for it. You'll be a crusader for it. I want everyone in this room to understand that your marriage is serious business with God. It's serious business with God. I want this relaxed posture that has crept into our culture to be eradicated. And I don't know how well I can do it throughout the earth, but I know that in this place, I can sure swing hard to try to make sure that we get on the same page. The same page. I'm asking, as we move forward, and we talk about marriage, we talk about our differences, we talk about relational things, and some of it will be funny, and you know, all those things. I can't do that outside of this context. I can't do it outside of this context. That our view, our perceptions, our attitude, our commitment to marriage will be striving to match God's. Lord, that you would put that same passion and fervor for marriage and the seriousness of it and the importance of the design that you designed it and the parameters that you set. Lord, that that would be just strong in my heart. Make me passionate for it. I believe with all my heart that's the commitment God wants from us as His church. Can't move forward. It's going to be difficult for you to allow Holy Spirit to work out relational differences if you can't first say, I agree with the seriousness of this and I understand the parameters of which it's supposed to operate. You're going to be out of luck. Holy Spirit will be quenched unless we're not on the same page with that. We want our marriages to be what they're supposed to be. We want to be in relationship with the Lord and right relationship with one another. And I want us to pledge. I want us to make a pledge together. I don't care if you signed up for it or not. Amen? We're going to do it. Everybody stand up. Wait. I want husband and wives to stand up. Husband and wives. Husband and wives. If you're here, you're not married, want to be here and in a relationship and thinking about it, looking, shopping, that's okay. That's okay. This is all for you too. This is as much for the sons and daughters in this room as it is for anybody. How healthy it is under a roof where mom and dad have a healthy relationship for your kids. It's a great atmosphere. It's the right atmosphere. It's actually the only atmosphere you really need and you want. Amen? You want this. You need this. And I want everybody, even if you're sitting down, I want you to be connected to this process, and I want you to pray for those marriages that are standing before you. Because the truth is that we're only as healthy as a church as we are as healthy with our families and our marriages. So this affects all of us. Whether you're standing or you're sitting, it affects all of us. So I want you to repeat after me. I want you to grab that spouse and hold your hands and hold hands. Come on. Honey, you can come on up here. Turn and look at each other for crying out loud. It's Valentine's. And even if your spouse is not here, it's okay. That's right. I want you to say these words. Just like you made your vows, you're fixing to do this, okay? Repeat after me. Lord, I recognize,
Lord, I recognize
that this miracle,
called marriage
is your design.
Is your design.
This design came from your heart.
It
came from your thoughts.
This design called marriage
is serious to you.
I understand that.
I recognize that.
And I commit my whole being
to surrender to that truth.
I recognize that my spirit
is willing.
Sometimes my flesh is weak.
I'm flawed.
But you, Lord, are perfect.
You are strong.
You are strong.
I ask Holy Spirit,
to help my heart,
to be totally given to yours.
Make me a better spouse.
Make me a crusader for your ways.
Concerning marriage.
Change me from the inside out.
Teach me to overcome
areas that have worked against my marriage.
Make my marriage a beacon,
a monument,
and a testimony
of what you designed marriage to look like.
Make me a successful husband.
Come on, men.
Make me a successful wife.
Come on, women.
Let our obedience to your word
bring you pleasure.
We thank you for love.
And we thank you for our marriage.
In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
You may kiss your bride.
Now, before we go, everybody can stand now. Everybody stand. Before we go, it's Valentine's Day all day. All day. All day. Have fun. Party on the patio with your honey. It's okay to turn on that 70s music or whatever.